So I already made a video on this topic where I focus on Momonga's upbringing in a dystopian future, the effect his transformation had on his psyche, and on different points of view from which to judge his actions. And today I want to take a closer look at one particular perspective. Might makes right. It's the Machiavellian point of view. So let me give you a quick rundown on his political philosophy first. At the end of the late medieval, many rulers were still educated via so-called mirrors for princes. Based on Christian belief and moral, future rulers are told how a good lord should behave. And then there was Machiavelli, and he did something different. He approached a more empirical method. Rather than telling the lords how they should behave, he studied them and tried to decipher which set of actions made a ruler successful and which policies and behavior patterns led to their downfall. And the instructions he came up with are not nice. Machiavelli advised rulers to betray every oath and to lie and cheat if it's in their best interest to do so. He told them that it is better to be feared rather than to be loved. And most importantly, he told them that virtue is not based on moral belief, but on the ability to force your will upon the world. Basically, it's a guide to amoral politics. And like in our own world, the society in which Neya grew up told everyone how it should be. The Holy Queen will lead the Holy Kingdom into a future where no one ever suffered. It's a beautiful vision. And without any means of realization. So at the start of the 12th novel, Neya Baraya had already chosen this point of view. She believed what her social environment believed as well, that the queen and her paladins were just, and that her enemies aren't. And at this time, Neya didn't question this perspective. All she had access to was this point of view. However, while traveling at the site of Ein Sol Gaon, not only did her physical location change, her stance on the subject of justice did change as well. She saw with her own keen eyes that the virtuous Remedios couldn't do anything against Yaldabaoth, nor could her sister, the queen, or all of those righteous paladins. The only ones who could act against the most dire of circumstances were people with the virtue of power. And Neya saw this kind of power put to use repeatedly. For example, by killing a hostage, Ein showed the demi-humans that taking hostages were not effective against him. Therefore, he prevented the death of many by sacrificing one single life. Neya saw that a cruel act can contribute to the greater well-being, just as a stupid act driven by righteous ideals can lead to one's downfall. Which is exactly what happened to Remedios. So much like Machiavelli did, Neya took a good hard look on how things really are. Rather than following idealistic dreams on how the world should be, Neya saw with her own keen eyes how the world is and what could realistically be done to change it. Those who wish to make a difference need to make an impact first. Might makes right. It has to be one of the most obvious and honest teachings a religion ever could have. I mean, most of our own religions are compelling us to join them or to face the wrath of an almighty being. But as mentioned before, this line of thought has a fatal mistake. Might alone has its limits. Forcing everyone to believe 1 plus 1 equals 3 wouldn't lead to a surplus of 50% or the return of Ray William Johnson. Its results would most likely be a fucked up government based on irrational policies that are enforced against reason itself. So Neya, after being resurrected by Eins, therefore came to the following conclusion. She wants her country and herself to become powerful, so that they can enforce their policies no matter the circumstance. And Neya most certainly has the strength, the connections, and the position to force her point of view upon the Holy Kingdom itself. So after taking in all of those things, is it right for Eins to wipe out half an army in a war of conquest in order to seize a single city? Are the actions of Demiurge always justified, no matter how cruel they are, simply because he has great power and his actions might lead to a utopian world united under eins. And how can there be even a neutral judge? I mean, most of us will never experience day-to-day life in the Holy Kingdom, or the New World for that matter. Therefore, I ask you, how would the citizens judge eins? Citizens that got tortured, that suffered all those losses. And how would future generations that grew up in a peaceful and prosperous world, ruled by the last of the supreme beings, think about those same actions? And which of those judgments would be just? And last but not least, how would you judge? Based on different points of views. So these were highly complex questions. And again, I can only exalt the brilliance of Overlord and its author to put that much content between a few lines of text. And after all those complex questions, I believe we all deserve some clarity in another field. Also, there's a test called MAG4, where you can see for yourself whether or not your own moral compass is in alignment with Machiavelli's rule set and, by a stretch, with Neya's newfounded religion. And this is all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I would be very pleased indeed to see you all again another time. Over and out.